welcome along to another episode of You Are The Ref, an episode which pits Charlie and Craig in debate as we go through some refereeing scenarios and ask what would you do if you were the ref. We're then going to give you the answers of referee extraordinaire Keith Hackett and let you know just how right or wrong you are.
Who's it specially endorsed by, Cody? Especially endorsed by, signed by, the book is signed.
Oh, sorry, I almost forgot about that.
How can you forget that?
The book is signed by none other than World Cup final referee Howard Rev.
Howard,
not
where?
That he mentions it on the page. And inside, as you know, we have two or three different refereeing and footballing men per page, and lots of unique, eccentric, as Charlie used earlier, images to go alongside them. And you'll love the image I've picked on one of them this week.
Who's the image today?
Today we are focusing on three scenarios relating to none other than another refereeing extraordinaire and current VAR head of operations and very worrying man, Mike Riley.
Right.
Why he's got the page in the book, I don't know. Maybe
he's
good friends with Keith Hackett. So, we're going to go through three scenarios as they're attached to each person. There is a wonderful illustration on the first one, which I'll try and explain to you. So the first one is, and let me know, as you were the ref, what would you do?
A big like, share, and subscribe to this channel. That's what you should do.
That is what you should do, but that won't help your refereeing standards. A big name striker who has been left out for the past three games is sent on for the last 5 minutes. But as soon as he steps onto the pitch, he runs up to a TV camera, pulls up his shirt and reveals a vest with a rude message about his manager, which causes the crowd to cheer. Now, the illustration they've used here is him pulling up the shirt and his vest underneath saying the manager is a cretin, which I just find absolutely brilliant. And there's the proof for it, just in case. It literally just says the manager is a cretin.
Oh, God.
Right. This is multiple choice.
Ooh. Oh,
so, would you A, have a quiet word with him, B, book him, or C, show him a red card, which shows the age of this book, because it doesn't even recognise female football.
Got to send him off.
But what for? Is that bringing
it's
the game?
Language.
Is it bringing the game to disrepute?
Technically, it is. Yes.
Is cretin abusive language? Is it? That's the same as idiot, isn't it? You may get set up for saying idiot.
Yeah, but why would you have a shirt like that? That's
I don't know if he's broken any laws.
I technically think he has.
But the shirt hasn't gone over his head. Is it to reveal a message?
Yeah, but with the old. What year was this book out? That's a rule, technically.
Let me just avoid the argument here. Obviously, a reminder from the first episode, this is a light-hearted discussion.
Oh, no.
We're not trying to make serious rule changes.
No.
So I'm going to ask Craig first on this occasion, just because I think it would be more fun. What would you do if you were the ref, Craig?
If I was the referee, if I was that good in the Premier League, I'd have to send the player off.
Okay.
I'd have to send him off because you've got to remember, it might be going to a TV camera. There's people obviously watching it on TV.
Yeah.
People behind the camera anyway, the fans-wise, they're still going to see it. And then little kids are going to see it and go, Daddy, what is a cretin? It's not the spirit of the game.
I think we need to talk about your child accent.
Well, Joe Pasquale, ask him.
Thank you for that comment. It made mine and Charlie's weekend.
Thank you, Jess. Moving on. I think you have to send the player off.
Okay.
It's stupid and naive for the player.
Fair enough. I'm moving on to Charlie. What would you do?
I'm going in the complete opposite direction. I think you haven't got any powers over this. You can only have a word of him. And I reference the Mario Balotelli, why always me scenario.
But that's not rude.
No, but hear me out. It's my turn, Craig. Shush. I reference that because it is.
Light-hearted.
I don't think cretin is technically found abusive language. Therefore, I think you can only have a word of him.
So what I like is that you both got so emotionally attached to this that you've completely forgotten the laws of the game and both got it wrong. Three choices and you both picked one of the wrong ones.
Is it really a booking?
Well, I suppose it's removing his shirt.
You will need to book the striker and restart play in the appropriate manner. Players must always remember that raising the shirt above the head is a cautionable offence.
But it wasn't. But that picture didn't show over his head, did it?
It did. He had the picture at the top of the shirt was over his head.
Oh, sorry, I didn't see that.
And I read in the description if you were listening. In this case, you talk about the offensive gesture, and Charlie's actually right on that regard. You don't have any right as the referee to do anything about it, regardless of the gesture, but it would be reported in your match report, and the authorities would deal with it later. And probably give a huge fine for what you've put on your shirt, and then give a minuscule fine for racism the week after.
Very true.
Sorry for not keeping it light.
That's true.
Moving on to number two of Mike Riley's extraordinaire scenarios,
right,
as commented on by Keith Hackett. In the dying seconds of a cup tie, a goalkeeper goes up for a corner and discards his gloves on the goal line.
Oh no.
You know, you like where this is going. And I don't know where it's going because I haven't read the rest of it. But the corner is cleared and with the keeper stranded upfield, the ball is booted back towards the empty net. But as it rolls towards the goal line, it hits the gloves and it's deflected wide. What do you give, Craig and Charlie?
Gosh.
I'm going to let you have a moment of discussion and then Charlie will go first.
Because it's not really a outside interference because it's technically someone's equipment. And he has to save.
But the only thing I can think of is that famous beach ball.
Yeah, that's what I would
say. The beach ball is an outside agent.
But could you then throw your glove at a shot? If someone shoots, can you just throw your glove
at it? If it moves like that, that's fantastic.
Well, then, could you throw your boot
at it?
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, you can throw your boot at it.
I said an icy one, because I'm thinking technically, if someone's about to shoot...
He's technically...
But even as a defender, as someone's about to shoot, could I take my boot off and throw it at the ball?
Well, technically, if you go about that, because technically no one's touched it, it's only someone's gloves, and it goes wide, it's a goal kick.
I think... Unfortunately, there's nothing you can do.
No, I think it's a goal kick.
I think you should. I think that. Well, actually, I'll just go with that. I don't think you can do anything.
You're going to say that you think it's a goal.
However.
But it didn't go in, though.
No, it went wide.
I'm sorry, you're going to say you're carrying on as normal.
The problem is, though, I'll tell you what the issue with this actually is you just made a great point. Is how do you restart it? Is that a corner then?
Well, no, because no one's technically touched it.
That's a tough one.
What's
disturbed the ball then? What's disturbed the ball?
Anything could disturb
it. Right, I tell you what, I'm going to go for
circles.
It.
I need a decision.
I'm going to go for it. I'm going to go.
Goal kick for me.
No, I've changed my mind because it's changed the direction of the ball. Drop ball.
Reason?
Because it's changed the direction of the ball and therefore it is interrupted play and it's not being worn or touched by anyone.
Okay, and on for Craig, I think you've got a different opinion on this, haven't you?
I'm going to go for goal kick.
And can I have the reasoning for that?
Because the person who's taking the shot is obviously, there's no one holding physically touching it afterwards, so and the ball's gone wide, so... For me, it's a goal kick.
Both pretty strong suggestions and pretty sound reasoning behind them. And one of you is right. But which one is it? It's Charlie Betts, nonetheless. That little refereeing course really hasn't paid off for you, isn't it, Charlie?
No, I don't know.
So you will award a drop ball. The gloves, once not being worn, count as an outside interference.
Ah,
so okay. Like the beach ball goal, it shouldn't have counted. Like any other obstacle, if it were a beach ball, it is an outside interference as long as they are not being worn, and that applies to any bit of equipment that you would normally have on as a player.
So you say if a ball goes like comes off a player's foot, and then it somehow trickles to the player's boot and goes wide, that's technically an outside agent.
I suppose technically, because he's not wearing it, he's not in contact with it. It'd be like that referee we had who used to wear a woolly hat. If that come off and it hit his woolly hat, that's an outside agent, isn't it?
I think the less said about that, the better.
Do you remember that? Sorry.
Yeah.
Just to finish off Keith Hackett's ruling, the drop ball, of course, must be awarded on the 6-yard line rather than the goal line because, like set pieces, the 6-yard line is
wow.
The only thing.
I didn't know that. I thought it'd be where from where you hit it from.
No.
So, 6-yard line is the furthest.
It's like a free kick like on the byline, like literally on the goal line.
If a goalkeeper wins a free kick, which often happens from corners where there's obstruction, it's always the edge of the 6-yard box.
Which I exactly just said.
Sorry. I thought you said the opposite way round.
Right, go on.
On to the third and final one, and I'm not looking forward to this because the answer looks very, very long.
Oh, very wordy.
Mike Riley for you.
The picture to go with it is the goalkeeper being hit on the head by the ball, so I'm not quite sure what to expect.
Oh, no.
But this is Mike Riley, so anything can happen.
He needs VAR. He needs about 23 cameras and 5 assists.
Get off your soapbox, Craig. Let him answer the question.
We start with a penalty taker who blasts the ball hard down the centre of the goal. It cannons straight into the goalkeeper's face and appears to knock him clean out. Nothing funny about that, Charlie. Before you react...
Have no shame.
Before you react, the referee, the penalty taker, taps home the rebound while the goalkeeper appears to be knocked out. There is uproar, as you would imagine.
No one
knows what's going on. No one knows the rule because it's so niche. But thankfully, you two are the ref. The defenders demand you disallow the goal. The attackers say you can't, of course. You're too late because you didn't blow up before the ball went in, say the attacking team. Everyone looks at you. What do you do? Now, have a moment to confer here, because this is niche, and the answer is humongous.
I know, obviously, head injuries are obviously, the referee has to stop the game. However, the ball's literally hit his face, and then gone straight to the attacker, and he scored straight away. So there's not enough time to react.
So tough. This is the hardest one I think you've asked out of all of the ones we've done so far.
Out of the 5 or 6 that we've had.
Well, I can confirm in the answer, Keith Hackett has had, for the first time in his book, to use an outside source to get his answer because he didn't know himself. He had to check his answer.
So he needed VAR.
Referee and extraordinaire had to check his answer.
He needed
VAR. I'll give you my position.
So thank God this didn't happen to him in a game.
I technically think it's a goal.
But The only thing that I would say is, as a referee, like, from the very few bits I remember from the course, like, safety of the players and stuff is paramount. But yes. Then I suppose, is this, but is
was
he in danger?
Was it rule then? Yeah. Was it rule? Obviously, head injuries.
It's all about the endangerment of the player.
But,
as well.
But how quick is that going to be, though? How quick is, like, boom, boom, boom?
Yeah. I don't know. That's so tough. I don't know if I'm
going to. It's literally a split second from the penalty struck to the ball hitting the face and
shot. However,
back to the
what I will say is it has had an
sportsmanship
effect.
Sportsmanship wise, you'll kick it wide.
Morally, yeah. Morally is a different issue. We can talk about what the team
as
wants to do.
But what I'm saying is, I think the moment he becomes unconscious, it's a danger. And also, it's interrupted the flow of the game. And what I mean by that is that the keeper is unable to save the ball. Because there might, you know, you don't know. There might have been a chance if he hadn't been knocked out. He could have saved the rebound. I think you have to, unfortunately, disallow the goal. But then what you do with it after that,
I don't know.
Is it a retake?
Drop ball?
I'm going to go out on a limb.
You can't say a retake.
Well, I don't know.
Why? Why would you do a retake?
Because of the endangerment of the player. He's knocked out.
How's that fair for the opposing team?
Well, it's not, but the thing is, I think either way they're getting shafted. Right, I'll tell you, I'm going to go with my answer. Retake of the penalty. So disallowed goal, retake the penalty. And obviously allowed the team to swap the goalkeeper if need be.
And Craig Savage?
You have to give the goal, I'm afraid. It's not enough time for the referee to react of ball beat in the face, ball going back to the attacker, and he's put into the net. It's not enough time.
So we've got Craig Savage going for a goal.
I'm going for a goal.
Because of the reaction
time. Just the reaction time.
Because the ball was put in before the referee had reacted.
Yes.
Charlie Betts, you are going for a retaken penalty and disallowed goal because of endangerment to the player.
Yeah.
And obviously, head law.
Yes.
Head injury law, sorry. Well, one of you's right again. And that man, on this occasion, to tie the game, is Craig Savage. Now, we need to be careful.
Yeah,
because
I understand his point. Retaking the penalty would have been a bit harsh.
Well, your answer is mentioned here, and not only is this Keith Hackett, this is FIFA with it.
Right,
so,
okay.
So, technically, award the goal is the correct answer.
Yeah.
Okay. The attackers are correct and no offence has been committed. Of course, they haven't committed an offence, we know that. This is an extremely challenging question, though. There is nothing in the laws of the game to cover this situation at the present, which is why it can't be a warner. And let me tell you, Keith Hackett has raised this with FIFA personally. I'm not sure who at FIFA, or whether that person, based on the timing of this book...
He's got to message Arsene Wenger now.
Based on the timing of this book being written, whether that person is still working at FIFA or in jail is another question. However, Keith Hackett checked with FIFA himself and we must trust him. But the answer goes on, we're not even halfway through it. As things stand, each individual referee would make their own judgment, as it's such a rare incident and many wouldn't know. And a lot of them would naturally act on morals. He has based his on this. If you had seen in time that the goalkeeper was unconscious before the ball was put in the back of the net, you would have blown up before it was scored. However, what happens next is where you would be wrong, Charlie. Because you would then have to award a drop ball where the keeper was hit.
Because
you can't afford a retaken penalty because there's no offence to cause that.
Yeah. That's extremely harsh given a retaken penalty. It's not the defending team's fault.
So no offence has been committed, so the only thing that can't occur is a retaken penalty.
I just thought because it hadn't technically... I suppose play had been restarted, I suppose. Yeah, that makes sense.
But however, as you see it in time... I didn't see it in time, and the keeper was unconscious, but the ball was in the net before you'd blown up.
Yeah.
The game would have counted until that point.
To be honest, the referee... The referee would probably be looking at the penalty taker and the ball, and probably players on the outside of the area just in case there's any encroachment.
I mean, what essentially is going to happen, let's be honest here, is whatever referee, let's hope it doesn't ever happen, but whatever referee this happens to in the future is going to wish they'd listened to this episode beforehand or read this book, because who realistically, anyone, is going to know that law?
Well, I think that, to be honest, as silly as it sounds, just to finish it off with, we've had an opinion. I'm sure you might have even had a slightly different one to the two of us.
Well, I would have gone for the drop ball one, to be honest.
Yeah, right, so... What I'm saying is it all three of us probably could have done that, and I don't think you'd have had a massive argument, maybe more so my one, but I don't think you'd have had a massive argument from people because it's such a unique niche situation that you just couldn't... I don't think anyone would go, well, actually, you're wrong.
And I think that's what Keith Hackett's saying. Yeah. This is the technicality, but realistically, no referee's going to really know what to do in that situation. He had to check.
Could you imagine being assessed? If you had, like,
you wouldn't get marked down anyway.
The assessor will have to use common sense.
Do you know what the assessor would do? Look up the answer.
Yeah, that's true.
Buy this book.
No,
but because most goalkeepers would normally, they would move.
I mean, you've got to be hit, yeah.
But a very interesting one to end on. We end in a tie. A brilliant book, brilliant illustrations. and wonderful answers from Keith Hackett. If you're unhappy with any of the answers in this book, Keith Hackett's your man to talk to. But thank you.
Don't message us.
But thank you for watching as always. We hope you're enjoying this We Are The Ref series. Make sure you like, share and subscribe for all of our content from the Honest Football Podcast. And you can follow us over on Twitter at Honest Football 3. Thanks for watching and we'll see you next time.